Yeah, let's now talk about cats and dogs and custom data loaders. I should say I just added cats and dogs to make this a little bit more interesting, because I can imagine if you just read data loaders or custom data loaders, it doesn't sound so exciting by itself. So I was like using that just to get your attention. But in any case, so here what I'm showing you is indeed a cats and dogs classifier I trained from a Kaggle dataset. So here I trained a VGG16 convolutional network that we will be discussing later in the convolutional network section or lecture. So here this is, think of it as just a neural network for the sake of having a model here that performs reasonably well on a more complicated data set. And in order to fit this model, I downloaded this data set from Kaggle containing cats and dogs images, but I needed to create a custom data loader for that. And in this video, I will show you how you can create a custom data loader. I will be using a simpler data set though, because then you don't have to download such a large cats and dogs data set. You can get this though and download it. So I have the code link here. If you're interested, you can download it from here. Or here I at least have the instructions how to download it, and I also have this model there. But I wanted to, before I show you the custom data loader, I wanted to make a few more points. So here I'm showing you the training loss and accuracy. So actually this should be the accuracy here on this axis. Don't want to hide the 90 here. And let's focus on the left-hand side first on the cross entropy. So you can see during training that the training loss goes down as expected. This is something you want to see. But you can see I'm using a validation set, and for the validation set, for each epoch I evaluate on the validation set, and you can see that here the loss does not go down. So at first it goes down, but then it stagnates. So in this case, we don't make any further improvement on the validation set while it continues to improve on the training set. So here we can see there is overfitting going on. So even if I train longer, I may still not be able to improve the model. On the right hand side, that's the same for accuracy, but the accuracy is usually, you can think of it as the cross entropy as a inverse surrogate for the accuracy, so it behaves similarly here. So you can see the accuracy goes up, continues to go up. That's maybe even, I would say maybe, let's say 97% even. But you can see for the validation set, it goes up and then it tends to stagnate. Maybe here at, I'll just say somewhere here, let's say maybe 88%, something like that. I then also evaluated the performance on an independent test set after the training has completed. On that training test set, I also get 88%, so maybe approximately like the validation set, which is kind of expected. So, what we can see here is extensive overfitting. And here the validation set gives us already an indicator of that. So we don't have to use our final test set necessarily. We can already see based on the validation set that there's overfitting. So the test set, it should only be used ideally one time in the end. It should be kept independent. So if you want to tune your model, you can do this entirely on the training and validation set. If you tune your model a lot, if you change a lot of hyperparameters and do a lot of tweaking, you may find that the validation set performance is actually a little bit better on the training set and during training, so when you evaluate it, but then it's not as good, it's better than the test set, because you will see that if you tune your model a lot, you will also slightly overfit to this validation set. Of course, you don't use your validation set for model training, right? So you don't fit the model on that data. You only use it to evaluate it during model training. However, just by chance, you may end up picking a model that just performs well on the validation set due to chance, and then you have this effect of overfitting. So in any case, the procedure I outlined using training set, validation set, and a test set for the final evaluation is the common approach in deep learning. In regular machine learning, we tend to use K-fold cross-validation, but it's a little bit too expensive for deep neural networks. And also because we have large data set sizes, like usually large validation and test sets, that's also usually okay. What is a good ratio when we use a training validation and test set? I think, it's relatively important to have a relatively large test set to get a reliable performance estimate. Also, it's useful to have a lot of data because we've seen in the previous video, the more data usually the better. So in that way, I would say make the validation set the smallest. It's still important because it gives you an idea of the model performance during training, but it's not as important as, let's say, the test set or the training set. So personally, for example, I would do something like 80% training data, 5% validation data, and 15% test data. But you can, of course, also change it. You can make it 85, 5, and 10 or something like that. So it really kind of depends also. There's no real correct way of doing that. It's usually something approximately around these values. So just to summarize, the training set is used for training, and it is not necessary to plot the training accuracy during training, but it can be useful. So you don't have to do the plots during training, right? But I find it useful to look at it, because then I can see, based on the validation and training accuracy curves, how much I'm overfitting. So the validation set provides a rough estimate of the generalization performance. It's kind of like the test set, but because we use the validation set a lot and we choose hyperparameters such that the model performs well on the validation set, it's not truly independent anymore, and we have an optimistic bias here. So from the validation set, the validation set would usually report a model performance that is slightly better than the model would perform on truly unseen data. Like I said, the test set should only be used once to get an unbiased estimate of the generalization performance. So this is like really in model evaluation in a nutshell in like a minute. So like I recommended in the previous video, if you want to know more details, I recommend the article I linked there. I will also link it again on Canvas. So here's how it looks like. You don't have to make plots. Also, usually when I train a model, especially if I do that on a server, I just print these values, like the training accuracy and the validation accuracy, and let it train. And then after training, I would print the test accuracy. There are multiple tools that can help you to monitor model training during training, so to take a look at these curves in real time. It requires some setup because we have so many important topics to cover in this class. I won't go into too much detail because it's like, I would say, more like an engineering thing, like a software engineering thing. So after you understood the basics of deep learning and are familiar with PyTorch, you can add more tools to your tool belt and explore additional tools. I don't want to cram too many tools into your tool belt right now. But if you're interested, you can explore them on your own in after class or for your projects. So some tools are, for example, that are nice are MLflow, and there are others. And these allow you also to plot performance values during training in a plot interactively. There's also TensorBoard. And TensorBoard is originally for TensorFlow, but it's also compatible now with PyTorch, and also a lot of people use TensorBoard. So you can maybe look at these two tools, but of course there are more. These are really only the two that spontaneously come to mind. But if you are interested, I can also share a list of more of those tools. In any case, so now, just before we get to the code in the next video, just a few more things to mention. There are parameters and hyperparameters. So just to recap, parameters are parameters like the weights and the biases in the model that are trained or learned from the training data. So that's what the model learns via backpropagation. However, there are hyperparameters, and I haven't used this word yet. I have used this word, but I haven't explained it yet, I think. So hyperparameters are, you can think of them as tuning parameters. So students who have taken 451 have encountered this in the context of k nearest neighbors as the number of neighbors and so forth. Here we have different hyperparameters. So here these tuning parameters are, for example, the mini batch size, the way we normalize the data, for example, min-max scaling, standardization, just dividing it by a constant. There are many different ways we can normalize data. And hyperparameters are really parameters you as the person who sets up the model, you have to choose them yourself and you have to try them out in practice and see what performs better. There's no way, let's say, we can use backpropagation to learn these. I mean, there are maybe some tricks or something, but usually this is something that is set up by the person who implements the neural networks. For example, the number of epochs can also be considered as a hyperparameter, or the number of hidden layers, the number of hidden units, everything really that affects the performance of the final model, the learning rate, to some extent also the random seed. So the random seed is something you probably shouldn't tune, but there are sometimes random seeds that don't produce good models because the initial starting weights are really bad. So usually I recommend if you want to report the final performance of a model, you present a model, I would recommend to run your model at least 3 or 5 times with different random seeds and then average over the results. And then you can also show the standard deviation or even confidence intervals. The loss function is a hyperparameter. Here, various weights in terms of weighting terms. You can weight certain examples more heavily than others in the loss function. The activation function, like sigmoid, a logistic sigmoid, 10H, or ReLU, and so forth. Regularization schemes, we will talk about that in the next lecture. Weight initialization schemes and optimization algorithms, these are all things we will cover in the next 3 lectures. So here there are really no good ways to choose these. Maybe there are some ways now, but based on meta learning, you can train your model on different data sets and you can see what performs well, or how you set up your model so that it performs well on different data sets. But in the grand scheme of things, it's something you still have to experiment with. So what I'm saying is there's no kind of scientific explanation for why theorem why certain parameters, hyperparameters, should work better than others. So what we have to do is we have to try many things. And there's this joke, probably like because of gradient descent, people call this graduate student descent, because graduate students usually, unfortunately, have to spend a lot of time tweaking these things, these hyperparameters. All right, so here's actually a nice visualization of a PyTorch data loader, how it works conceptually. I just saw it the other day, and I thought it might be fun to include it in the video because it's really a nice summary of how things work. So I saw this here on Twitter, the original link. But yeah, let's just play the video here. So you can see, let me stop it first. Let me explain first and then I start the video. So on the left-hand side, you are shown the inputs and the labels in the data set. So this is your data set. Then there are certain transformation methods. We will cover this in detail when I show you the data loader in action. Then there's a sampler and a batch sampler. So the sampler samples one pair of inputs and labels at a time. The batch sampler samples them for a batch, and then the collate function combines them to a mini batch that we can use in the model. So let's play this again. So you can see the inputs and labels go through the transform and through the sampler and get collected in this batch sampler. Once we have a batch ready, it goes to the collate function and it produces the batch of inputs and batch of labels. And then it does the next batch. And you can see here it's sampled without repetition, so each sample is used exactly once, also each pair of inputs and labels. And then once we are finished, we finish the epoch, and then there will be another epoch. So you can see they are also chosen randomly here, so it's basically equivalent to shuffling. So then the last batch here. All right, Yes, so and then you would do the whole thing again, but of course, yeah, you would choose them in a different order if you have, there's a parameter, it's called shuffle. If you have shuffle enabled, it will choose them in a different order then. Yeah, this is conceptually how the PyTorch loader works. So here's how it looks like in code. And yeah, I think I should make a separate video and walk you through this in the Jupyter notebook. It will be a little bit better to explain compared to walking you through it here on the screenshot. So just to wrap up the slides before we go to the last video of this lecture, to the code example. So we have now the good news that we can solve nonlinear problems. That's great, right? Now we have the bad news, that is that our multi-layer neural networks now have a lot of parameters, and yeah, it's easy to overfit the data. So in the next lecture we will talk about techniques, like regularization techniques, to help prevent overfitting. So here's a simplified example of how that might look like. So if we have, for example, a model in the center here that is maybe too complicated and doesn't generalize well to new data, then here on the right hand side there is a model that is slightly simpler. We can make it even more simple, like just this linear decision boundary, but this is not sufficient here to distinguish between these crosses and circles. So there's usually a good compromise between a model that is, let's say, overfitting, it has high variance, or a model that is underfitting, that has high bias. So regularization helps to simplify decision boundaries in a certain way, if you think of it as, if you think about it visually. But yeah, we will talk more about that in the next lecture. So in the next video, also the next video, I will show you the custom data loader in practice.